So good afternoon, and I just started the recording. So welcome back to the course of rocket propulsion. We are talking about chemical rockets, and in particular, we arrived to discuss this kind of rockets starting from the more general case of thermal rockets. Going ahead, can you hear me and see the screen?
Sì, professore.
Okay, thank you. And we first analyze thermal rockets, and we know that specific impulse is given by the product of these two quantities, these two performance parameters, which are the thrust coefficient and characteristic velocity, where we have this first parameter accounting for the quality of the expansion process, so the conversion of internal energy to kinetic energy, whereas the C star parameter, the characteristic velocity, tell us about something about the energy content that we have available for getting a high speed jet. So in the ideal nozzle, what you have seen, the ideal nozzle, which is the common part of all thermal rockets, we have seen that the energy can be expressed as related to the total temperature, the gas constant, and to the gamma of the gases which expand throughout the nozzle. So you see here that we have two quantities, R and or better three quantities, R, T0 and gamma, that are define our C star for this special case. And we can ask also about this quantity, because this is the universal gas gas constant, and this is the gas constant, which is related to the universal gas constant and the molar mass. And so we can ask here what is M, what is T0, and what is gamma. So to answer this quantity, we have to identify what is the energy content of our gas. And this, we are now looking inside these three quantities for the case of chemical rockets. We started from the first law of thermodynamics, and that based, of course, on the conservation of the energy. And we introduced the heat of formation, or the enthalpy of formation of elementary of molecules starting from elementary species in their standard state. And we, at this point, we arrive to define something which is related to this T0 in case we have no heat exchange with surroundings, so for us, outside our engine, there are no heat losses. And in this case, we can evaluate our adiabatic flame temperature. We recall that in general we have that Q, the heat delivered by per unit mass is related to the change of composition between product and reactants. In general, we have a different mass fraction of each species between their occurrence in product and the reactants, and this should be multiplied by the enthalpy of formation per unit mass here. And there is also to consider the change of sensible enthalpy. So for the product, we have to consider the temperature of products and for reactants, of course, the mass fraction and enthalpy of reactants. So from this expression, if we consider Q equal to zero adiabatic, and we consider as known the mass fractions of reactants and products, and also the little formation of each species, and finally the reactant temperature, the only unknown that remains in this equation is the product temperature, that will be taken as the adiabatic firm temperature, because this will be the temperature that is reached by the mixture of products if there is no exchange with surroundings, and so all the heat released by our combustion reaction is given to our gases, which is something that we would like according to what we see here in the expression of C star, that where we would like to have the maximum temperature, so we don't want that there is some heat release towards surroundings. So if this, and you have seen that considering the correctly the properties of a thermally perfect gas, we can evaluate, we can correctly estimate this adiabatic flame temperature once all these quantities are given. So the question is, what is actually known and what is not among these different quantities? Of course, we can consider that we start from some initial conditions, let's say, that tell us that we know what is the reactant temperature. We can also consider that we know that reactants are in a given proportion, and so we also know our YIR, the mass fractions of reactants. We, moreover, the values of the standard enthalpy of formation for each species, either reactants or products, is something which is known. It's available in tables where we have these values that have been evaluated once for all, for each of the species we can consider. So these quantities are all actually known. The question comes about YIP. Is this quantity known or not? The answer, of course, is that it is not known, because the result of a reaction is something that depends on the chemical reaction process. So we will start from reactants, and interaction of these reactants will rearrange chemical bonds, releasing energy and creating new molecules, but with a process that needs time, and that reach at given point an equilibrium condition. And this equilibrium condition is something that is a dynamic process where we have creation and destruction of different molecules. So, and there can be different results of these reactions. So actually, if we consider this basic reaction, this is the formation reaction of water vapor, starting from, for instance, from the molecular hydrogen and oxygen in this proportion, we have assumed so far that we have this single product of reaction. But in general, this is not the case. From one side, we have that at the same time, we have formation of H2O, but also destruction of H2O, forming H2 and O2 by dissociation. And on the other hand, we have also the appearance of different molecules or atoms, like OH And so let's bring it in parentheses. We can have also OH, HO, H2, O2, HO2. So many different possible combination of these atoms. Consider that the atoms that we have at the beginning must be conserved, so they can rearrange their bonds different ways, but we have always the same number of atoms. So what will be the composition of the mixture, our YIP, that we need for the evaluation of the adiabatic flame temperature? Actually, we will reach, if we suppose that we have enough time for the reaction to evolve, we will reach what we call an equilibrium condition, a chemical equilibrium condition. This is will be the most stable condition, not necessarily given by all the change of H2 and O2 in H2O, but the most stable condition, the minimum energy state. So if for this energy balance that allow us to evaluate, once we know YIP, the adiabatic flame temperature, we have resorted to the first law of thermodynamics to consider the equilibrium condition, we will resort to the second law of thermodynamics. And also on the Gibbs free energy that we introduced at the end of last class. The Gibbs free energy our quantity that we represent with the symbol G, and it's found also with F in the literature, but we will follow this notation. It's a particularly convenient quantity if we will refer to isothermal and isobaric processes. We can see that if we start from the second law of thermodynamics, we have that the change of entropy must be greater than the heat, which is exchanged with surroundings. And by considering, for instance, the equal sign, you can see that, not considering equal sign, if we consider the first law of thermodynamics, we can see that this delta Q we have seen that can be expressed in terms of dG plus TdS plus SdT minus VdP. And so we can make this substitution here, and we can see that on both sides we have TdS. And so overall we have that dG plus SdT minus VdP must be less than zero. So of course the fact that we have the inequality sign means that we are also considering irreversible processes. So the reversible process corresponds to the equality in this expression. So in general, if we consider here the reaction process in general, and this we are considering the quantity relevant to the mixture, what we can see, and this is G, you see that the changes, if you're considering an isobaric isothermal process, so with these two terms that vanish, we have that if T is equal to constant, P constant, you have that dG must be less than zero. So it means that by spontaneous processes, we have a decrease of G. And this will happen in any case. We are always going to decrease this G, except when we reach this point, which is the minimum, where we cannot decrease G, so we reach the minimum condition where we have that this inequality becomes an equality. We will have dg is equal to zero, and this would be the minimum energy state that represents our equilibrium condition. It also corresponds to the fact that there are no longer currents, there are no longer irreversible processes. So if we can also change this inequality, making appear, as we did last time, the irreversible entropy, or the change of entropy, increase of entropy due to irreversible processes. And we write this in this way, TdS must be greater than this delta Q. That means that should be delta Q plus something, which is the amount of entropy generated by irreversible processes. And of course, making the same substitution, you can see that dg plus s dt minus vdp must be equal to minus t ds due to irreversible processes. Now, let's see what happens for our mixture, and let's see how we can exploit this relation to evaluate our equilibrium condition. What we consider is that in our mixture, we have that G can be expressed as the sum of the molar specific Gibbs free energy, GI, by the number of moles, or of course also in terms of mass specific values. And if we look to the definition of the Gibbs free energy for, of course, the single species will be again also here H minus TS, all with this over bar are all molar quantities, and can be done the same also for the mass specific quantities. So in general, as we have seen also for the entropy and the extensive quantities, we see here that our G will be a function of temperature, pressure, and also, as you see here, because if GI is a function of, for instance, T and P, and the overall value will be also a function of the number of moles, as you see from this expression here. Well, once we say that this will be the dependence, we can also, and you compare with this expression, we can say that our dg can be expressed in terms of partial derivatives with respect to the different quantities that define its value. So we can write this dg as dg dt, considering constant Ni and P, dg dp at constant Ni and T, and finally dg dNi for each value of I, of course. So we should sum this. Sorry. So here we have to consider that these derivatives are made with respect to keeping constant Pt and let's say Ni when Nj, sorry, with J different from Y. D and I. So we have this expression and we can compare this with the expression that we obtain from, again, from here. That will be dg is equal to minus sdt plus vdp minus t as irreversible process. So you see that here this quantity being this related to T pressure and temperature and pressure and corresponds to the first two terms, this term corresponds to the last term here. And so you see that the irreversible changes of this free energy due to the change of composition are related to this term related to irreversible processes. So the processes that move towards, spontaneously towards an equilibrium state. So, and in fact, we can also, well, actually, we should also consider here something more based on this other expression here. We can also differentiate this expression and say dg will be sum of ni dgi plus sum gi dni. And from here, from this expression, we can relate now again this quantity with this one, whereas here we have something, our gi is a function of t and p, so you see that this will make together these two terms. So overall we can say that our change of entropy due to irreversible process can be expressed as minus 1 over t, and we can see this term here, let's keep it short without writing constant quantities here, are all the other different from an I. Or looking to this second path, we have minus 1 over t, so comparing these two expressions, minus 1 over t sum gi dni. Okay, so something interesting, of course, that probably you already know, but it's important to underline here. We see that we have this important quantity that appears in this expression, which is the partial molar free energy, partial because it's for a given species, molar because of molar quantity, and the free energy, which is also called chemical potential. You can find it with different symbols, as for instance also mu sometimes. And why this is important? Because as we said, we have, when we reach the equilibrium condition, we have that this quantity, this ds, will reach zero, and it means that we have that the relation that give us that this change of entropy vanish is given by this expression. So this will be the condition that you have to satisfy to consider our mixer in equilibrium. So let's go make first step analyzing this expression. So first of all, we should see what's the meaning of this D and I. And we will keep us something that allow us to have an example, always this reaction that now we consider in both directions. So let's suppose that we have a change of number of molecules of H2, which is reacting with this proportion with oxygen. Let's suppose that we have a change DNH2. So what you see that from here, if we have that something, let's say if we are consuming hydrogen and oxygen to get water vapor, we will have a decrease, let's say minus DNH2 of number of moles of hydrogen, we will have at the same time, let's say minus 1/2 of the moles of O2 that will disappear, because for each mole of H2 there will be 1/2 mole of O2 that will be consumed, and we will create with the D here, and we will create number of moles of H2O that will be the same as the number of hydrogen molecules that we have destroyed, that have been reacted. So we can identify a quantity that represents the advancement of reaction. We'll call it, let's say, the xi. And we see here that the number of moles that we are consuming of hydrogen will be related to this number here that we have in front of our species in this reaction. That multiplies this dx sign. For instance, here we can express this as minus 1 dx sign minus 1/2 dx sign, and here plus 1 dx sign. So you see that in general, given this advancement of reaction from left to right, if the dx is positive, we have that the quantities will change in this proportion. So it's particularly convenient to write our reaction in this way. And for the present case means that nu 1 is equal to 1, nu 2 is equal to, is minus 1. Nu 2 is minus 1/2, and nu 3 is equal to 1, A1 is equal to H2, A2 is equal to O2, and A3 is H2O. And you see here that our DN, I, will be given by nu I, the xi. So we take We call this stoichiometric coefficients. Of the reaction, and we'll take them as negative if you are considering reactants and positive if you are considering products. And this will be, you see that our change of number of moles is related to the advancement of reaction. Of course, if we go in the other direction, we'll have the xi less than zero. But this is important because we can replace this expression within our condition for the equilibrium that we have written before. So if we have that sum gi dni equal to zero, this becomes, let's say, sum gi nu I the xi equal to zero. And of course we can have different, in general we can assume any advancement in either direction of this reaction. We consider advancement from left to right, from left to left, from right to left, and so any values of the xi. So except considering the case where there is no advancement of the reaction, we see that we have a further condition such that this equality can hold, and which is the following. So you see that the Gibbs phi, molar Gibbs phi energy, the partial value of it, multiplied by the stoichiometric coefficient and summed for all the species must be equal to zero. And this is the condition for the equilibrium for given value, in particularly, of course, this GI depends on pressure and temperature, so we have this condition that will be different for each values of pressure and temperature. For given pressure and temperature, we have this condition for the equilibrium. So we see that we have a different equilibrium condition, and so a different composition depending on the value of pressure and temperature that we are considering. So at this point we have to, we can try to express this partial molar Gibbs phi energy and see how we can relate to the, of course, the, our unknown, where our YIP that we still don't see here. So in general, of course, we have that G will be H minus TS, and so we should express our H and S. And we recall that we have already done this for the enthalpy. We have introduced standard conditions and the enthalpy of formation such that our generic HI can be expressed in terms of the enthalpy of formation plus the sensible enthalpy. And of course, we should find also an expression for the entropy. And here we have the molar specific entropy. And what we have seen for single species is that our Si will be equal to the reference value of this species plus the, this function phi for the E species, sorry, for the I species, and also we can identify, let's say, reference pressure and express the final term of the partial pressure of that species referred to the reference value. So of course we have this reference value here, this reference value here, and we should also consider that we have a reference value on this phi, because phi will be in general the integral from reference temperature to the given temperature of our Cp dT over T. So we have to put everything together, and to do that is convenient to identify a condition, a reference condition for this entropy. For the entropy, what is done usually is to refer, well, to exploit the zero law of thermodynamics, stating that S should be equal to zero when temperature is zero Kelvin. So to be consistent with this quantity and consistent with what we do here for the enthalpy, based on this, we can evaluate the entropy at standard conditions. Standard conditions means T0 and P0, that are 298.15 Kelvin and one atmosphere of pressure. So of course, being zero, the entropy here at zero Kelvin, it will be that S0 is not zero, but its value can be tabulated, and we can find it in four different species that are of our interest. So if we assume at this point as reference values this temperature, and as reference pressure the atmospheric pressure, and so you see that here if we consider that Pi is equal to P0 and Phi I based on this zero will be zero at standard condition, we see that this S reference I is exactly this value for that species. So in general, if this is the value when we are at P0, T0, there will be in general the expression saying that we have here plus phi I, and of course minus R logarithm of Pi over P0. So we can generalize the expression of the entropy in this way, and we can use this together with this other one to express our Gi. So we have here delta HFi0 plus integral from T0 to T of Cpi dt, this is H, minus Ts, so minus Tsi0 minus T phi I, and plus RT logarithm of pi I over P0. So we can see that we have one constant value here, and we have also this constant for the entropy, And we have different quantities. For instance, this depends on only on t. Here we have again all these quantities that only depends on t, and finally we have this part that will depend on t and p. So we can consider a reference constant value that I would like to identify here as G00 to say that this is a standard pressure and temperature, and this is a constant, and will be delta H Fi0 molar minus, so at standard temperature, the temperature will be T0, so this term is zero, this will be T0 Si0, and this will be zero again because Phi I will be zero at the standard temperature. And at standard pressure, we have logarithm of one here, so this is zero too. So at the end, the only term remaining here will be minus T0 Si0. So if I now consider the G I0, that means that this will be a standard pressure, but for generic temperature, the logarithmic term will be again zero, but we have all these other quantities. So we can say, of course, you will have here T Si0, not T0 Si0. And so if you introduce this constant value, Gi with double zero here, we have also to sum T0 Si0. And so it will be minus T0 Si0 plus. And then we have the two terms related to the constant pressure specific heat, which are this one that comes from the enthalpy, and also with the minus, we have this T phi I. Good, so we have at this point this expression for the partial molar free energy or chemical potential, and you see that Gi0 is a function of only the temperature. So this is evaluated at P0, which is one atmosphere, or 100,325 Pascal. This helps us to write the generic value of Gi, that will be a function of temperature and pressure, and it will be Gi0 T plus the terms which depend on pressure, that also depends on temperature. So it will be plus RT by the logarithm of PI over P0. So this is a convenient expression that should be seen together with our relation sum Ni Gi, that now we can express in terms of T and Pi equal to zero. So we have these two relations that allow us to find our equilibrium condition. We now make a break of 10 minutes and we will resume at 5:10. So we start now from these two relations, And if I consider the first one inside the second one, we have that sum ui gi0, which depends only on t, plus the sum of nu I rt by the logarithm of pi over p0. It should be equal to zero. So we can also bring on one side this term and bring outside of the summation the term RT that multiplies each of the quantities within summation symbol. And then we can consider this as the sum of different logarithms with the coefficient in front that becomes also the product of a different values of I of the logarithm of pi over p0 to the power nu I. This will be within parentheses here. So we can identify two different groups, one that depends on the amount of each quantity of each species through pi, and other term which only depends on the stoichiometric coefficient and the temperature. And in practice we can write that I equal to 1 to number of species of the ratio of pi over p0 to the power nu I will be equal to, of course, I made an error here because this is the logarithm of the product. In this way, so that I can group, I can solve for this, and we see that all the remaining terms are only depending on temperature. And so this logarithm will be the exponential coming from this expression. The argument of the logarithm will be the exponential of the other quantities. That will be the summation nu I. GI0 over RT. So we see that all the right hand side is just a function of temperature, and we refer to this as the equilibrium constant Kp, which is a function of temperature for that reaction. And at this point, we have a relation among the different, at least molar fraction, because I can write that pi is equal to xi by p. This is the expression for the partial pressure, it's a function of the mixture pressure. And so according to what we have written here, we will have that this is also can be expressed in terms of molar fraction. Before doing this, let's consider a different kind of nomenclature now. that can be also convenient is to consider now that the psychometric coefficient for the products, which are our new I, is identical, and our new IR for the reactants, that they are changes of sign. So when you use this nomenclature, it means that we are always taking, considering positive values. And here in this expression, we see that we have a group of terms with positive exponent when you consider this new I, which are the products, and other terms in this product having a negative exponent, which are the reactants. So we can also write this KPT as the products of 1 to up to NP for the products, and will be PI over P0 UIP. So we sum all the products here. There was the positive exponent, whereas for the negative exponent, we have pi I equal to 1, 2, and R for the reactants, pi over p0, nu I reactants. And we are doing this because now let's look to what happens if we substitute with the partial pressure expressions function of molar fractions. So you see here that we have now pi, and there will be p over p0 to this new IP that multiplies, of course, XI new IP. And similarly on the denominator. So you see here that we have the same quantity with different exponents is multiplying this, and so overall we see that we'll have all this fraction that will be multiplied by p over p0 so many times as according to the different exponents. So I'll have here the sum of new I P minus the sum of new IR, and then our products of XI new IP and XI new IR. So in this way we can see that there is a dependence on pressure on this part and a dependence on molar fraction on this other term. So we can separate the dependence on pressure, and we can identify this delta nu as the sum of nu IP minus sum 1 and R, I equal 1 and P, U, I, R. And finally write KPT is P over P0 delta nu, and then the product of products, molar fractions, to their stoichiometric coefficient divided by the product of molar fraction of reactants to their stoichiometric coefficient. So this is the relation between the molar fraction and for a, and the given temperature and pressure, where of course this KPT is what we have written before. You see here the expression, but it can be also written in terms of new IP and new IR. New IP G I 0 and R new I R G I 0 divided by R T. So what's meaning is that if we know, in practice, we have just to know the stoichiometric coefficients and the values of the reference constant in the expression of GI for each species, the expression of the CP, that is the same as saying that we know the sensible enthalpy as function of temperature, we can also evaluate, starting from these properties of each species, the value of the equilibrium constant. You record here, let me find it. So you see here the expression, and you recall that this is a constant, and this is something which is a function of temperature through this constant, and through the expression here, and also in phi of CPI. So once you know CPI as function of temperature, you know GI0 as function of temperature, this one. And so you also know KP. And these actually are something, are values that which are known, in particular the CP of each species are interpolated from the experience through polynomials typically. And from this, we can obtain our equilibrium constant for each kind of reaction. So we can also comment on this expression saying that the final composition that we have for a given reaction depends for sure on temperature. But we see that it may depend or not on pressure, depending on the stoichiometric coefficient that define that reaction. We define this delta nu as the order of the reaction. And we say that it's zero order reaction if the delta nu is equal to zero. And in this case, there is no effect of pressure. We say order one, if this delta nu is one, and so on with different values of delta nu, where we see that what is this change or this effect of the of pressure. So let's see some examples. Reaction of O2 dissociating in two atoms of oxygen. This is the reaction of formation of atomic oxygen. So what we see here is new, of course, the sum of new IP is just new one, which is the only product that we have, which is two, and the sum of new IR will be again new one R, which is one. And so we see that delta nu is equal to one for this reaction, which is first order. This is an example of first order reaction. An example of zero order reaction is the following: H2 plus O2 giving H2O plus O. And we see that some new IP is new 1 plus new 2. That would be 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, and similarly, it's equal to 0. Here we can write 2 minus 1 is equal to 1. And the reaction that we have considered so far as an example is H2 plus 1 half O2 giving H2O. In this case, we see that the sum of stoichiometric coefficient for the products is 1, whereas the sum of stoichiometric coefficient for reactants is 1 plus 1 half, that is 3 halves. And so delta nu in this case is a fraction, that will be minus 1 half. So it's 1 half order reaction. So in the first case, let's look to here and see what happens. If we have, in the first case, we have delta nu is equal to 1. So it's safe to say that the corresponding value, if we take a given value of pressure, if we see the higher pressure, is equivalent to say that we have at a higher pressure a lower value of the equilibrium constant, a lower value of Kp. Lower value means that this product here on the numerator will be lower than the product denominator. And this is equivalent, we will see examples. We have to consider the different species and their behavior, but at the end, what we see is that in this case, we have less dissociation and more recombination. So in this kind of reaction with first order, or let's say if we have that this delta nu is positive, we see that we have it means that is something like a reaction like this, like a dissociation, and we see that the role of pressure is to enhance recombination and to discourage dissociation. In the second case, there is always the same result independently of pressure, because we have delta nu is equal to zero. And in the third case, we have that the exponent, this delta nu, is negative. That means that increasing pressure, we increase the equilibrium constant. And this means that we are enhancing, encouraging the formation of H2O for a given value of temperature. So this relation here, this one, is also referred to as the law of mass action. and is what allows to evaluate the equilibrium composition for a given pressure and temperature. So let's to better understand what we are talking about, the order of reaction, the effects on the equilibrium constant, and the final result, let's consider again this reaction here. So in this case, we have that we can express our equilibrium constant as pressure in atmosphere, so this was P over P0 to minus 1/2, and then XH2O, XH2 square root of XO2. So you see that the higher KP, the higher B, the because we have to consider that in our mixer we have the species as reactants and products. So you see that by this relation, the higher Kp, the higher XH2O, and the lower B XH2 and XO2. It means that higher value of Kp implies higher amount of products. And so you see that here the higher pressure will increase the corresponding value of, we have here P over P0 Kp is equal to this. And so we see that if pressure for a given temperature increases, it's the same to say that Kp increases. So we have more products and less reactants for that temperature. Of course, then we have to see how this Kp depends on temperature, and this is something that we will discuss later. Now, we see that what we have here is not sufficient to know what is the our goal, that was to evaluate our YIP, or equivalently, of course, if we know our X is the same, we can get one from the other. But you see here that we have 3x and we have one equation. So actually we don't close the problem, but we have to consider a further, couple of further reaction relation that we have. One is that the sum of x is equal to 1, all the fractions do summed give us the rule, and on the other hand we have also to consider the conservation of atoms. That means that we have the same atoms before and after reaction. So if we start from a given amount of reactants, we know the YIR and so the XIR. We can say that we have this given amounts, for instance, X2 in this proportion. And now we write the same balance that we have written before as a dynamic balance of this reaction can be seen. Also, this is the initial condition, and we have a final condition. We have a given number of molecules of hydrogen, a given number of molecules of oxygen. So there will be some amount of reactants and some amount of products as the final result of this reaction. So we have these unknowns, which are related to our x, of course. So it's as to say xH2O, xH2, and xO2. Actually, these are number of moles. So it will be that xH2 is equal to A over A plus B plus C, xO2 will be B and xH2 will be C over A plus B plus C. So what are the relations that we have available? One is this one. And this is one. We have three unknowns, A, B, C, and or X, X, X. One equation is the one given before, and the other two equations are related to the conservation of atoms. So it means that if we have given number of moles of H2, let's say one mole of H2, we will have here that the number of atoms will be the same. So we have to say that this one should be equal to the number of atoms will be twice the number of moles. We have two atoms for each mole of hydrogen. And we have two atoms on the left-hand side for each mole of hydrogen. And 2A plus 2C atoms on the right-hand side. So let's say that, let's make it clearer. We have that on the left-hand side, the number of if we have given number of hydrogen molecules, let's say NH2R, this corresponds to a number of atoms, which is 2 times this number. And on the right-hand side, the number of atoms that we have of hydrogen will be 2A by the number of moles, because this is written for one mole. So the number of molecules and we have for there will be two atoms of hydrogen here, no atoms of hydrogen here, and two atoms of hydrogen here. So this is why I'm writing this in this way. So overall we have this relation. Which is equivalent to count the number of atoms that we have on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side. And similarly, you can do for the oxygen. You can write 1/2 multiplied by 2 on the left-hand side. And we have here 2B plus 1 in C. So we have these two relations together with this relation here. We have found three equations in three unknowns, and we can solve the problem. And let's do it. We have this can be written as A plus C is equal to 1, and the second one can be written again 2B plus C is equal to 1. So we have that, taking the difference here, we have that A equal to B and c is equal to 1 minus 2b, for instance. And we have to, for instance, we can solve at this point for the, let's write our x. I don't know why I written this in this way. Probably it would be better to write everything as a function of a. Yes. So let's say that c is equal to 1 minus a, and b would be 1 half a, right? Yes. At this point, x, h2 will be a over the number of moles that we have on the right-hand side will be related to this number a by this relation. Yes, and c is plus c, 1 minus a, right? So we can write here, we can cancel this term, and this would be 2a over a plus 2. And similarly, x u2 will be 1 half a over 1 half a plus 1. And so we multiply everything by 2 and will be a over a plus 2. And finally, x h2o will be c, which is 1 minus a, and here we have half a plus 1. And so we have 2 minus 2 a plus 2. We can make our substitution here in this expression. There was one up here. We have Kp, p over p 0 to 1 half. Will be equal to the products would be just H2O on the numerator, and it would be so 2 minus 1 A over A plus 2, and then we have this would be divided by the products of x h2 and the square root of x o2 like this, where we can simplify these two terms and group everything under the square root. And we have here, it seems that I can also simplify 2 here. And you see that we have 1 minus a squared. I have also a plus 2. And here a squared. A squared here, and also a, so it becomes a cube. So overall, this is just as an example. You see that we have a cubic equation in the in a, in the unknown a, plus 2, sorry. So this is the equation that allow you to evaluate your A, and as a consequence, for each value of T through Kp and of P through this P over P0. And so you can evaluate, of course, once you know your A, you can also know your value of X. And for instance, you can see for this equation that you will have something like this. As the solution. This is H, X, H2, X, O2, and X, H2O. Where we see that this is a function of temperature for a given pressure. So let's say this is a standard condition. We see that actually that at the beginning, at low temperature, we have just H2O. We have no reactants that are unbound. Well, as I move towards higher temperature, we have some fraction of H2 and O2. But we see, so this is just to tell us that the equilibrium condition can be different and depends on temperature, and the relative amount of reactants and products changes according to the temperature. So actually, this is a first point that you have seen, and we have been able to solve for the equilibrium condition for a given reaction. Let's say this was just a formation reaction of H2O. Of course, this kind of if we are evaluating the adiabatic frame temperature, the change of composition of the product mixture will change also the final value of temperature, and you have to take into account the sensible enthalpy as depending on temperature of different species. But even if we made this step, this is still something ideal for two reasons. One is that we are considering the stoichiometric proportion, H2 plus 1 alpha 2. In general, it could also be something H2 plus O2 is, for instance, we have too much oxygen here. No. It's H2O plus 1R4, right? 1R42, for instance, or H2O plus O. This is possible. Different situation where we have that reactants are not in stoichiometric proportion, so they were burned in the stoichiometric proportion, whereas in this case we have some oxidizer than stoichiometric proportion, so there will be some residual oxidizer that we have among the products. So this is something that we have not considered so far. And moreover, is that if we make this, as I said before, if we make this species to react, we have also to consider the formation of different molecules like HO, OH, or if we go further, HO2, H2O2, O3, and so on. So So despite that, we try to evaluate our adiabatic flame temperature. We go back to our case where we have found this A, and we try to compute our adiabatic flame temperature. So at this point, we know A from this equation, and so we can express our, balance of absolute entropy that allow us to compute the adiabatic flame temperature. And so it will be an IHI. This is the absolute entropy. And these are the reactants and products. So this is expressed in with the moles of reactants and products. And we can take one mole of H2 that corresponds to among the reactants and for the products. We have this in H2 is equal to A, and O2 is equal to 1/2 A, this is 1/2, and H and H2O will be equal to 1 minus A. This is what we have seen before in terms of X or of N, if we like to use them here. And we see here that we can express, we can make explicit the sensible and formation entropy, and say A sensible entropy of H2 TAF, and also for 1/2 A H S O2 TAF. This is, I'm making explicit this term, and where the entropy of formation only appears for the water vapor. So we have plus 1 minus A here, HS, H2O, TAF, and then we have plus 1 minus A, number of moles, again, by delta HF, H2O, 0 molar. And this must be equal to the sensible entropy of reactants. Sensible entropy because we have that they are species at their standard conditions and molecules standard corresponding to the standard condition of the relevant species, and so their formation entropy is zero. So actually, if the TR is equal to standard temperature, this will be zero. So what is the difference? The difference is that with respect to the former case where we had the complete reaction, and so we had that A is equal to zero. So in that case, we adjust to evaluate the equality between the sensible entropy and the formation entropy of H2O. In this case, we have also to consider the sensible entropy of the unburned reactants, and we have less heat release because we have this term here that corresponds to incomplete conversion of reactants in products. So we have in this case, we can write that the sensible entropy of water vapor at the body frame temperature will be equal to the formation enthalpy of water vapor minus this term. Plus 1/2 HSO2TAF. So hopefully I wrote everything correctly. And you see that here the difference is just this quantity. And you see that necessarily if this is a positive term, as it is, because we have the enthalpy at a temperature greater than the standard temperature, we have, this is also positive quantity, minus a positive quantity. So it means that something less, and this means that TAF with equilibrium is less than TAF for the complete reaction. And if you put numbers inside, we see that here, at standard condition, we have it results that TAF will be equal to 3500 Kelvin, which is less than what we have computed before, that it was, so the TAF complete, equilibrium, perspective F complete, that was 4,120 Kelvin. So this is results that is obtained by A equal to 0.35, which is what we have, what we can find for this problem. So this is the first step. We will complete discussion on the body frame temperature and the composition of products, considering the occurrence, the presence of different species. And in this case, we have to consider also different equilibrium reaction that will be the equilibrium of formation reaction of each of the species that participate, that is part of the product mixture. This ends the lecture of today, and we will continue discussing about that in the next class.
Professore, buon pomeriggio. Posso parlare?